All right, ladies and gentlemen, I am back, and unfortunately, the NFL regular season is officially over with. And with the regular season being over with, today I wanted to talk about every single team's 2023 and 24 season. I'm not going to be able to give like a full explanation or recap everything that happened this year for each team, but I can give you guys a quick little 30-second synopsis for each team. So without further ado, and not to waste anyone's time, let's just hop right into it. Whenever I usually do these 32-team recaps, I usually do them in alphabetical order, but today I thought I would do it by conference. We are going to be starting off with the AFC, and then next we're going to be moving on to the NFC. We will start with the AFC North, and then we're going to end with the NFC West. I will try my best to put timestamps in the description below, so if you want to check that out, go ahead and check out the description to see your favorite team. But as I said, we are going to start off with the AFC North, and more specifically, the Baltimore Ravens. Now, as we all know, the Baltimore Ravens had one of the best regular seasons we've seen in quite some time. They went 13-4, they scored 483 points and only gave up 280 points, which means if you calculate their net point differential, it was 203 points, which is absolutely astronomical. For context, the Cleveland Browns point differential was 34, the Steelers was negative 20, and the Bengals was negative 18. So for the Ravens to have 203 net point differential is just remarkable. Lamar Jackson will likely win MVP, their head coach should be in consideration for coach of the year, and that is one of the best defenses in quite some time. As of today, I think the Ravens have got to be one of the favorites to win the Super Bowl, so shout out to you Ravens fans, you guys had a great year. Cleveland, we are almost back. Now, if you guys had LeBron James as your quarterback, you might be winning a Super Bowl, but you guys don't. You guys have good old Joe Flacco, so I'm not sure how far he can take you guys, but I hope he can take you guys pretty far. Coming into this year, I actually had you guys as my favorite to win the division, so for you guys to end up in second place, I feel pretty good about myself. They scored a total of 396 points and had given up 362, and I think the biggest story that happened this year for the Cleveland Browns was the fact that Deshaun Watson got replaced by Joe Flacco and then got outplayed by Joe Flacco. This Browns team has been very competitive with almost every team they played this year. They have some good wins over really good teams like San Francisco and the Baltimore Ravens. So in the AFC, I definitely do think the Browns are going to make some noise. Next up, the Pittsburgh Steelers went 10-7, and this is one of the most grittiest teams you're ever going to find. At one point this season, NFL fans were calling for Mike Tomlin's job. They were also calling for George Pickens' job, and I'll be honest with you guys, I was myself. But then they fired Matt Canada, and it just kind of felt like this team rallied together in a good way. They ended the season off 10-7 and did a fine job this year of making a playoff spot. Is this team going to win a playoff game? I seriously doubt it, but I do want to give them their shoutouts for at least making the playoffs after all the turmoil they've been through this year. So for all the Steelers fans who actually did watch my most recent Steelers video, I feel like I owe you guys a bit of an apology because I did not paint you guys in the best light. In that video, we talked about the culture problem, but it does feel like that problem somewhat got fixed this year, or at least they put a shiny little coat over it to kind of hide it from the media. But you guys made the playoffs, Mike Tomlin continues his winning streak, and who knows what can happen in the playoffs as a whole new season. And the last team in the AFC North is the Cincinnati Bengals, and I think the best way to kind of recap your guys' season would be injuries. I mean, Joe Burrow injury, Ja'Marr Chase injury, T. Higgins injury. A lot of your major stars and some people who kind of carry your roster were either injured or were struggling through injuries the entire season. And it's hard to win games when your starting quarterback, your starting receiver is going through a bunch of injuries. The fact this team actually won 9 games, in my opinion, is pretty impressive. Listen, this team has some problems. They're going to be likely losing T. Higgins this offseason. They're going to have to pay big bucks to a guy like Ja'Marr Chase. But I really don't feel like the offense is that big of a problem. I do think they should look to address the receiving 2 problem if they do lose a guy in T. Higgins. But if I was a GM, I would put a little bit more focus on the defensive side of things because I do think that is the biggest problem for this unit. Same thing with the offensive line. That still has been a big problem for this team. But all in all, the AFC North was one of the best conferences in the entire NFL, but we are going to go ahead and move on next to the AFC East, and this was a very competitive division, mainly between two teams. And as we all know, both the Bills and the Dolphins battled it out last night to win the division, and of course the Buffalo Bills did come on top. And after a 6-6 start to their season where everyone was calling for their coach's job and everyone was calling out Josh Allen for his turnovers, they finished off with a 5-game winning streak and put together a pretty good season in total. On the year, they scored 451 points and only gave up 311. Which, if you want to know their point differential, is 140, which is damn good. For context, again, the Patriots had a negative 130, so I definitely do feel like the Bills had a good season all things together. Josh Allen should be considered for the MVP, though I don't think he should be over guys like Dak, Brock, or Lamar Jackson. But I think the number one thing that happened this year was you guys figured out your identity. And in a sense, you kind of figured out how to hold back Josh Allen in certain moments. So I feel like you guys had a good season, and I feel like you guys can make a run in the playoffs. Next is the Miami Dolphins, and I've heard some Dolphins fans say this is the lowest they've felt in quite some time, but I need to remind you guys of those Ryan Tannehill years, it could definitely be worse. You're 11-6, you have a matchup with the Kansas City Chiefs, and I think if you win that game, you gotta feel pretty confident about yourself. If this team did not lose guys like Jalen Phillips and Bradley Chubb, this team might be a little bit more competitive. But injuries definitely hurt their season, but I still think this team has a very good chance of being very competitive within the playoffs. the New York Jets. One of my favorite teams coming into this season. In fact, I actually had them winning this division, lost their starting quarterback in the very first series of the season. And I think all things considered, the fact this team went 7-10 just tells you how good of a defense that Robert Saleh has. Do I think that Saleh should be on the hot seat? Not necessarily, because I think the defense did a good job this year. But when you have a net point differential of negative 87 and your offense only scored 268 points in 17 games, I think it might be time to fire Nathaniel Hackett and figure out this offense. You're hopefully going to have Aaron Rodgers next year, but this offensive line is just absolutely atrocious. I fully expect this team to give Breece Hall at least 25 carries a game next year if they want to find ways to win games. Because as great as Aaron Rodgers is, he's almost 40 years old, or maybe at this point he is 40, he's on a torn Achilles and he's going to be very cautious on his legs. So I expect a full load from Breece Hall next year. Look out for him in fantasy. And lastly, the mediocre team of this division, surprisingly, was the New England Patriots. Bill Belichick is likely gone in a season where they went 4-13 and the offense only scored 236 points on the season. They went 1-8 on the home games and 3-5 in road games. They also went 2-4 in the division games, and it was just a rough season all in all for the New England Patriots. They are a shell of what they used to be, and I kind of think it's time to clean house for both the roster perspective as well as the coaching perspective. This is a massive offseason for the New England Patriots. I think they will get a quarterback this offseason to fix a lot of their problems with the roster, but again, I kind of expect a little bit of a clean house next year. So all in all, the AFC East was kind of a mixed bag. You had two really good teams and two really bad teams, but for all intensive purposes, I do feel like the AFC East was a very fun division to watch throughout the season, and I think moving forward, that division is only going to continue to grow and get better. So keep an eye out on the division next year when the Patriots potentially get their future quarterback and Aaron Rodgers comes back healthy for the New York Jets. But moving on, we're going to now talk about the AFC South. And if I'm going to be honest with you guys, I feel like this was maybe the funnest division in totality to watch this year. Obviously going to start off with the Houston Texans, and the fact that they actually won this division is just incredible. CJ Stroud, Will Anderson, and DeMeco Ryan-son, all of their rookie seasons played phenomenal. And for DeMeco's sake, he did a hell of a job coaching that unit. The defense took strides, the offense took strides, the offensive line really was not as bad as we thought it would be. And all in all, you cannot give enough credit to the GM of the Houston Texans. They did a fantastic job of building this roster heading into the season. There was legitimate thoughts that this team was only going to win one or two games this year and come back next year with no first round pick of their own and have to wait for the Cleveland Browns pick, but they currently made the playoffs, went 10-7, and had a fantastic season. They tied for the second most points in the division. They only gave up 353 points on the season, which is the lowest within their division, and had a net point differential of positive 24. So shout out to Houston, you have a good one in Stroud, Will Anderson, and DeMeco Ryan-son. Next up, on the flip side of things, the Jacksonville Jaguars. They went 9-8 and had a pretty disastrous end to their season. This was a team that we all expected to take the next step, and they failed to do so. Trevor Lawrence was playing through some injuries, but he definitely regressed this year. And as a whole, the unit did not progress like we thought they would be this year. We're going to have a ton of content on them this offseason, but I have a lot of concerns for this team moving forward. On the flip side, yet again, the Indianapolis Colts, and unlike the Jaguars, they definitely did better than what I thought they would be this year, especially after the Anthony Richardson injury. They went 9-8, scored 396 points, but the defense gave up 415. And with Anthony Richardson coming back, I definitely do think this team could take the next step next year. I think the biggest thing this team needs to address next year has got to be something along the defense. Whether it's getting a lockdown corner or maybe adding something in the safety room, I think that has to be addressed. Because when I think of the offense, I think of Jonathan Taylor, Anthony Richardson, and the offensive line. So sure, going out there and getting a receiver in the first round could definitely be nice, but I definitely do think it has to be something on the defensive side of things. Shout out to the Colts for Shane Steichen's rookie year, Anthony Richardson's small little portion of the season, and Gardner Minshew playing like a very good quarterback. And lastly, the Tennessee Titans, who went 6-11, scored 305 points and gave up 367 points. This was a team that went 5-4 in home games but 1-7 in road games, and there's a lot of negative but also positive things that you can take from the season for the Tennessee Titans. It appears you have your rookie quarterback of the future in Will Levis, but more than likely we're going to see a couple big names this offseason, or at least next offseason, move on, guys like DeAndre Hopkins and Derrick Henry. The offensive line was bad, which was kind of to be expected, and the defense was just kind of average, which again was to be expected. Mike Vrabel does have to do a very good job of drafting this year to fix a lot of the problems along this offensive line and defense, but I do think that if Will Levis can put together a nice sophomore campaign, this team could definitely take the next step. All in all, the AFC South was a blast to watch this year, and I hope teams like the Texans, the Jaguars, the Colts, and the Titans can take the next step next year to make this division even better and more competitive. That is one of the youngest divisions in the entire NFL, and I'm so excited for those teams. And lastly, on a bit of a sour note, the AFC West, and truth be told, it was not a lot of good football being played in this division. We're obviously going to start off with the Kansas City Chiefs, who of course won the division, but even for the Chiefs' sake of things, they did not play a lot of really good football this year. They went 11-6, scored 371 points, and only gave up 294, but they weren't their typical dominant self like we expect them to be. Mahomes looked a little bit more human this year with some lesser weapons. The offensive line regressed heavily, and the defensive side of things, while it had some really good moments, also had a couple bad moments. This team is going to have to be carried by Patrick Mahomes in the defense come this postseason, and I just don't know if that's going to be enough to beat certain teams like the Dolphins, the Bills, or the Ravens. But as long as you have Mahomes, you have a chance, so I guess we'll have to wait and see. In second place, my very own Las Vegas Raiders went 8-9, and truth be told, that's better than what I thought they were going to be this year. I came into the season with zero faith in Jimmy Garoppolo and zero faith in Josh McDaniels, and rightfully so, they both got replaced. AP seems to be the coach of the future for this franchise, and I cannot be more happy about that. It seems to me like the culture and identity of this roster is starting to form, and I think once this team goes out there and gets their quarterback and can somewhat address some of the problems this team did have this year, they can be a decent team next year. I'm just saying, throwing it out there, if they get a Bo Nix, a Michael Penix, a Jaden Daniels, I think this Raiders franchise might be really good next year, so keep an eye out for them this offseason. We're going to talk about them a ton. Next up is the Denver Broncos, and what a weird year for the Broncos. This season started off about as bad as it could get. They obviously had the embarrassing loss to the Miami Dolphins, but then around the middle to late half of the season, they started to figure things out and went on a bit of a winning streak before they ultimately collapsed in the last couple weeks. With that said, though, I think there's a couple positives you could definitely take from the season. Cortland Sutton played great, the offensive line played better, the defense figured things out in the second half, and Sean Payton seems to be having enough with Russell Wilson, so it does appear that they're going to be moving on from him to get a new franchise quarterback. So I guess only good things can only happen for this Broncos team, but I don't really know if I expect them to take the next step next year. They're going to have to figure out a lot of things and also sell me on a lot of the moves they're going to make next year. And lastly is the Los Angeles Chargers, who went 5-12 and had a very bad season. They finally decided to fire Brandon Staley, and I think that this was a couple weeks too late. Herbert went through some injuries, the team in totality played really bad this year even when they were healthy, and they're going to be an older franchise that has a ton of money that they're going to have to pitch forward to a bunch of really good players. And this team does not have the most amount of cap space to work with, so they have a lot of issues they're going to have to figure out this offseason. But I think the number one thing that has to be addressed, they have to find their head coach. Chargers fans want Jim Harbaugh. I'm not the biggest fan of that, but I can definitely see where they're coming from. I guess we're going to have to wait to see who they pick up. So that was the AFC West, and like I said earlier, it was a bit of a disappointing season for them. Teams like the Broncos, the Raiders, the Chargers, and even the Chiefs were all expected to play really good next year, and unfortunately, all four of those teams took a step back, including the Kansas City Chiefs. So it's going to be very interesting to see what moves they make this offseason, because all four of these teams have significant holes they have to figure out. So all in all, the AFC was a mixed bag, from really good teams to really bad teams, from teams that we thought were going to take the next step that didn't, to teams that we did not expect to take the next step but did. And I think when we move forward with this conference, it's only going to get better and better, with teams like the Titans, the Jags, the Texans, the Colts, the Jets, and some of these other teams that are going to be getting franchise quarterbacks this offseason are only going to get better and make this conference even better. But moving on, we are now going to talk about the NFC, and we're going to start off with the NFC North. And for, at least for myself, this division went a lot how I expected it to go. I expected it to be very competitive, but I thought the Lions and Packers were going to be the 1-2 seed, and I expected the Vikings and the Bears to be kind of mediocre this year, which it just so happened to be. And starting off with the Lions, you went 12-5, you had a very good season, the offense and the defense played pretty good at times, even though the defense kind of had some bad games as well. But offensively speaking, you scored 461 points, which is one of the highest in the NFL. And you won 12 games and finally won the division, so shout out to the Lions fans, I'm sure they're very happy. As for how far I think they can go in the playoffs, I definitely do think this team could take a run for it, but I don't think they're going to make it to the Super Bowl, but we're definitely just going to have to wait and see. Green Bay, I definitely did kind of expect Jordan Love to have a better second half to the season. My expectations for this team was that they would struggle early on, and then as the season went on, it would pick up. And that's essentially what happened. The start of the season was very bad. They were just a really bad to mediocre team. Jordan Love was trying to find his footing and trying to find ways to win games. And defensively speaking, it was about as bad as it could get. And then as the year went on, they got better and better and started to string in some really good wins. They even beat teams like Kansas City, and they also beat the Detroit Lions on Thanksgiving, and they fucking made the playoffs. So shout out to the Green Bay Packers. I don't think they're going to win a game in the playoffs, but the fact they made the playoffs in Jordan Love's first year as a starter is pretty impressive. Next up is the Minnesota Vikings, and as I said in the start of this, I didn't think that they were going to have a very good season this year. Granted, if Kirk Cousins stayed healthy, I do think this team could have potentially made a run for the division, because offensively, you basically have everything you want except a run game. And I know Jefferson did miss some time this year, but your other weapons like Jordan Addison and TJ Hockenson had very good seasons. And defensively speaking, this team was a lot better than they were last year. It's still not a top 10 unit, but Brian Flores did a good job of sort of reinventing the wheel for this defense. And I think if Kirk Cousins was playing this year, I definitely do think this Vikings team could have taken that next step forward to maybe not be contenders, but to potentially win the division. And then of course, the Chicago Bears finished last place in the division, and it was a roller coaster of a season for this team. I think you saw some good things from the young guys you drafted, as well as some good things from Justin Fields, but just not the consistency you want from this franchise. guys, fortunately for you guys, you guys have the number one overall pick. You also have what I believe to be a top 15 pick with your own pick as well. So you're going to be able to address some potential needs for this roster. Now, whether or not they decide to keep Justin Fields, I don't have the answer to that. I personally have my mixed feelings on it. At some points this year, I thought they were definitely moving on from him. And then at other points, I thought they were going to keep him. And now that the season is over with, I just still don't have really a big answer for that. And I'll probably look to address that this offseason with what I would personally do. But you went 7-10, which I think was kind of the expectation for this year. You're going to have two top 15 picks, and you definitely have the chance to make your roster a ton better. And before I move on to the next division, I want to talk about Matt Eberflus. Should he be kept? I don't think he should be, but I also don't really see a replacement in line for him quite yet. So I kind of feel like they're going to be forced to keep him this year because of how many coaching changes are going to happen. But that's a question for another day. We'll see what happens this offseason. All in all, the NFC North was a fun division. It was interesting at times. And of course, seeing the Detroit Lions and the Green Bay Packers duke it out for the division was very fun. And of course, anytime the Detroit Lions find success, we have to root for them. So shout out to the Detroit Lions for winning this division. But let's go ahead and move on to the NFC East. And what a weird year it was for this NFC East. The division was won by the Dallas Cowboys, and again, I don't want to toot my own horn here, but I did say the Cowboys were going to win this division at the beginning of this year. The Cowboys went 12-5, scored 509 points, and gave up 315, which means they had a net point differential of 194. The Cowboys went 8-0 in home games, and 4-5 in road games, and 5-1 in division games. They absolutely obliterated the New York Giants twice, the Washington Commanders twice, and the Philadelphia Eagles once. So for the Cowboys' sake, I definitely do think they are legitimate contenders, and I think overall it was a very successful season for this team. Micah Parsons and Deron Bland are both Defensive Player of the Year candidates. Dak Prescott has a very good case to win the MVP this year, and you got to give credit to Mike McCarthy for willing this team to get to where they are today. So shout out to the Cowboys. I know they have a ton of haters, but I do think this team is going to make it very far this playoff run. Next up is the Philadelphia Eagles, and let's just get this out of the way. This is one of the biggest collapses we've seen in quite some time. This is a collapse that reminds me so much of the Kyler Murray and DeAndre Hopkins Cardinals team, and the Chase Claypool and Ben Roethlisberger Steelers team that won so many games and then collapsed at the late end of the season. They went 11-6, and at one point, I believe they were like 11-1, and then they got destroyed by San Francisco and the Dallas Cowboys in back-to-back weeks. And most recently, they struggled to beat the Giants, they then lost to the Cardinals, and then lost to the New York Giants in the last week of the season. This is a team that looks like they have given up completely, and it's a shame because just last year, they were in the Super Bowl, and at the start of the season, they looked poised to make another Super Bowl run. Jalen Hurts has taken a step back, the offensive line has taken a step back, AJ Brown has taken a step back, and we can't talk about this team without talking about the travesty of how bad the coaching staff and the defense has been this year. And as somebody who kind of considers himself a bit of a Cowboys fan, I love seeing the Philadelphia Eagles struggle. They are probably my least favorite team in the NFL, so sue me, Eagles fans, I don't care. Next up is the New York Giants, and from a season last year where they won a playoff game to where they are now, it has been a complete 180 of where they were supposed to be this year. This was supposed to be the big step forward for them, and they failed to do that. They went 6-11, scored 266 points, and the defense gave up 407. And while there are definitely some bright spots for this team this year, obviously last week they just beat the Philadelphia Eagles, which I'm sure felt great. They are currently in a position that 99% of teams do not want to be in. They paid Daniel Jones a crap ton of money just to be a below average starting quarterback for the start of the season before ultimately going on the IR to be replaced by Tyrod Taylor and Tommy DeVito, who played better than him. Defensively speaking, it was a damn mess. Shout out Deontay Banks, he had a good second half of the season though. And all in all, this team has a long way to go before they can get back to where they were just last year. And lastly, the Washington Commanders, and it's really hard to talk about anything with this franchise because it was just a total mess from start to finish. Ron Rivera is gone, the whole coaching staff is gone, Sam Howell will not be the quarterback for this team next year. Defensively speaking, they gave up 518 points, and as a whole, they had a net point differential of -189. I didn't think the Commanders would be good, but I thought at the bare minimum, they would be at least mid, but they were outright just awful, and I don't want to put all the blame on Sam Howell because he didn't really get a ton of help this year, but I fully expect this franchise to get their starting quarterback next year. But they're going to have to address a lot of their needs this offseason before they get their quarterback, which means fixing the offensive line and fixing the defensive problems. And for their sake, I hope that Emmanuel Forbes does get better next year, but I don't really see it. So all in all, the NFC East was a division that was basically destroyed by the Dallas Cowboys when you look back at it. Sure, Philly had a very good start to their season, but then they had a terrible collapse late in the year, and the Cowboys were 5-1 against all those teams, and in those 5 wins, destroyed them. Philadelphia is an embarrassment of a franchise currently, same with the Giants and the Commanders, so pretty bad division in totality. Next up is the NFC South, and this is a division that will go down in the history books because of how bad it truly was. The fact that there's going to be a 9-8 divisional winner who's going to be hosting a playoff game is just ridiculous to me. And the sad part is, I actually think they're going to beat the Philadelphia Eagles at home next week, but we'll get to that in a separate video. Let's start off with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, who went 9-8, scored 348 points, but gave up 325. And we kind of got a glimpse at the Baker Mayfield resurgence, which is, of course, a very good sign for this team moving forward. I don't expect them to fire Todd Bowles or get rid of Baker Mayfield, but I also don't see this team getting to that next step anytime soon. Baker is good enough to be just an average quarterback, but let's not overrate him that much. He's just an average quarterback at this point, and this team really doesn't have a bright future, but they also don't have a dark future. They're just kind of stuck in mediocrity. Same thing kind of applies to the New Orleans Saints, who also went 9-8, but had a pretty good offensive season, especially late in the season. They scored 402 points and only gave up 327 points, but despite that, only won 9 games. And I feel like most of their production came very late this season. As the season went on, Derek Carr started to pick up things, and I don't know, it's just been a rough season for Saints fans in totality. The first half of the season was just really bad, and they were just mediocre, and then at the middle point of the season, it just felt like everything was collapsing, and then towards the back end, everything sort of fixed itself out. But you still missed the playoffs, and you're still negative however much million dollars there are in cap space. They're a decent team, but they're not a great team, and they're just going to be stuck in mediocrity for quite some time. Now on to the Atlanta Falcons, and hallelujah, Arthur Smith was fired. And it went out with a bang. He got into a fist fight with Dennis Allen. I'm exaggerating, it was just a yell match, but it was still freaking awesome. They went 7-10, and Bijan Robinson, Drake London, and Kyle Pitts all failed to hit 1,000 yards. Desmond Ridder was absolutely horrible, so was Taylor Heineke, and this team is going to be getting their franchise quarterback this offseason. My hope will be restored next year once they get a good head coach and a good quarterback to finish this roster out, because defensively speaking, it's actually pretty damn good. It just needs the offense to find the consistency, but we'll just have to wait and see what they do this offseason. And lastly, the Carolina Panthers, and where do we even start with this franchise? They went 2-15, scored 236 points total, and gave up 416. And, they don't have their first round pick either. So this team will be bad next year as well, more than likely. And Bryce Young's first two seasons are going to be absolute disaster classes. Somebody free my boy Bryce Young, send him to the Las Vegas Raiders, I am begging you. But all in all, the NFC South was absolutely trash this year. Did I have fun watching any of their games this year? Hell no. Will I watch any other games next year? Maybe if the Falcons draft a good quarterback, but we shall wait to see. And lastly, we have the NFC West, and it was a division that was dominated by one team and one team only, the San Francisco 49ers. They went 12-5, scored 491 points and only gave up 298, and had a net point differential of 193. They went 5-1 in the division, and their only loss came in week 18, where their starting quarterback was Sam Darnold. They are my favorites to win the NFC, and they are just a complete powerhouse. This was kind of to be expected from the San Francisco 49ers. They have literally the Avengers for a roster, and they did not take any steps back. We all expected them to take steps forward, and they quite literally took steps forward in basically every position. I might come off as a bit of a hater here, but I actually really hope they lose to a team like the LA Rams or the Dallas Cowboys. That would just be amazing, in my opinion. They're just too cocky, in my opinion. I just don't like cocky teams. I like humble, nice teams, and they're just not that. But if that's what gets them out of bed every morning and makes them win games, then go right ahead, San Francisco. On the flip side of things, the LA Rams went 10-7, scored 404 points, and 377 points were allowed. They had a net point differential of 27, and similar to the 49ers, had a divisional record of 5-1. And this was a very good season for the LA Rams. It started off very shaky, but as time went on, it got better and better. Matthew Stafford made the Pro Bowl. Finally, he deserves it 100%. I hear everyone saying Jordan Love, but no, Stafford deserved it more. Puka Nacua and Kyron Williams are franchise cornerstones for this team moving forward. The offensive line played better as the year went on, and defensively speaking, there was definitely some bright spots as well. I am very excited to see where this team goes moving forward. Next up is the Seattle Seahawks, who went 9-8 and had a bit of a disappointing season. I do personally think this team should replace Geno Smith, as well as potentially replace a guy in Pete Carroll. The offensive line was bad, the defense was horrendous, and Geno Smith was just kind of mediocre when he played. Not to discredit Geno Smith, I still think he's a top 20 quarterback, but he's not a Super Bowl winning quarterback in my opinion. At the very end of this video, I will pin my Seahawks video if you haven't checked it out, so make sure to check out that video if you are a Seahawks fan. And lastly, the Arizona Cardinals, who went 4-13 and actually had a pretty decent season, all things considered. Was the defense bad? Yes, but that was to be expected because there's quite literally like zero talent on that defense. But Kyler Murray and that offense was fine this year. They did a good job of settling the ship, and they won 4 games, which was 4 more than I expected. Jonathan Gannon looks to be pretty decent, and I like this team's future moving forward. I am going to be making a Cardinals video in the next couple days, so keep an eye out for that if you are a Cardinals fan. But all in all, the NFC West was a fun division this year, and I had a ton of fun watching the Rams, the Seahawks, and the Cardinals duke out certain games. And while I may not like the San Francisco 49ers, I must admit they play a very good brand of football. So all in all, this division was fun, and I think it's only going to get better moving forward. But before I close out this video, I want to give you guys a quick little montage of all the great moments we had this season. So, here it is.
Go Broncos country. Let's ride, baby.
There it is! This is history! If Bayern can take it the distance, this will be the record! Here's a sling, there's Nacua, and there is one of the two records remaining.
Is going to launch. Hardy downfield, overthrown, it's picked!
Darren Wallace from the 25. Darren Wallace breaks out of the tackle, takes it down the sideline.
He stays in bounds, he stays on his feet, he takes
it down 13. Blitz coming. Prescott able to get out of the end zone, and now airs it out for Lamb. He's got it, he's gone!
Rams, the former first round pick of the Bears, and now Rodgers sits down.
Alrighty guys, hope you guys did enjoy the video, and if you guys did, make sure to hit the like and subscribe button. We have a ton of content coming out for the rest of the offseason as well as the postseason, so make sure you guys stick around. We are currently on the road to 1,000 subscribers, and we are itching close it every single day. I want to say a quick thank you to everyone who watched this video and everyone who has been supporting me. It has been such a fun season, and we have so much content planned moving forward. But I love you guys. Peace.